Good morning, everyone. Exactly 1 year ago today, Boris Johnson appeared on our television screens and told the UK that all non-essential social contact had to cease. 1 week later, we were in a government-mandated national lockdown. The 12 months since then have been rocky for real estate, and while things are looking better than that day a year ago, the path ahead is still unclear for real estate capital markets. I'm Mike Phillips, UK editor at BizNow, and welcome to today's webinar, Financing and Available Capital in an Uncertain Environment. Today, we've got two great sessions which will give you an insight into where both debt and equity are looking to be deployed in the next 12 months as real estate undertakes its recovery and beyond. Before we get started, I'd like to say a huge thank you to our three partners for today's event, our presenting partners, Aldermore and Hill, top credit partners, and our moderating partner, Fried Frank. Thank you so much to everyone there for their insight in helping us to put together today's sessions. Now, coming up in just over 15 minutes time, we'll have a panel discussion with a host of luminaries from the real estate capital markets. But first of all, I have the pleasure of interviewing our keynote speaker, Paul Oberschneider, founder and CEO of Hilltop Credit Partners. Paul has a long and storied career in real estate investment and lending both in the US and Europe. And Hilltop, his most recent venture, is a specialist residential real estate debt provider. And we're going to be chatting about the current residential lending environment and the opportunities there. You will have the opportunity to ask Paul questions, so do file those in the Q&A section at the bottom of your screens, and we'll have time to get to maybe a couple of those at the end. Paul, thanks so much for joining us this morning. Just explain to our audience very briefly why we're in suit and ties, even though I'm sat in my kitchen. Oh, you're on mute, Paul. There we go. Get it out of the way early. Great stuff. Yeah.
You'd think after 12 months I'd figure this out. Good morning from London. Thanks, Mike. Thanks for inviting me on the show. It's a real privilege to be here. Suit and tie. Yeah, no, I could have worn a hoodie, but you know, we decided that we'd all been in lockdown for so long that we've called this sort of Tie Tuesday. So, you know, I'm glad you got the memo. You're wearing a tie as well.
Yeah, it sparks some nostalgia for me, certainly. So, Paul, we saw last week an announcement from Hilltop that there'd been a new investment made by Metropolitan Real Estate Partners, the real estate multi-manager. Tell us about that and what that means and what you're going to be doing with that in investment.
Well, yeah, I mean, Metropolitan's a great name, aren't they? And they're a great capital partner for us. So we're really excited about that. They've got a great team. And, you know, we've been working with them for the last, you know, 9-10 months putting this together. So we had been warehousing deals in our portfolio, and we did a GP-led secondary with Metropolitan. So they are now providing us capital, and we'll be recycling that over the course of the next couple of years. But you know, for our team, it's great because it's super validation of what we've been doing in the space since we originally launched. And, you know, there's a lot of stuff that goes on behind the curtains in lending. I mean, lending is a very specific, residential development lending is very specific and takes a lot of different skill sets. So, you know, it took us about a year to put that in place, and we actually started funding deals really almost about a year ago, right into COVID. And we were all really uncertain about what was going to happen. And, you know, a lot of our peers, a lot of people just kind of like shut the doors and looked at their legacy books. And, you know, we didn't have a legacy book to worry about. So we just kind of chopped wood and plowed ahead. And the result was that, you know, surprisingly or not, I mean, the residential real estate space, you know, acted extremely well and was extremely robust for the last 12 months. I mean, surprisingly so. So we've been very fortunate to kind of be in the right place at the right time. But we're really excited about Metropolitan, yes.
Sure. And tell us about the kind of deals you do, sort of who is Hilltop, the kind of deals you're looking at and why.
Well, you kind of have to dial back a little bit. So I've historically, I've been a developer investment manager. So, you know, the team here has a sort of an equity DNA, if you will, in terms of development. And when we started to look at the market a couple of years ago, you know, we looked at the supply and demand imbalances in the market and the dislocations that was creating. And we thought, how could we add value or alpha to our investors as well as to our partners? So basically what Hilltop does is, you know, we're, as you pointed out, you know, we're a specialist financing partner that provides capital to sponsors that know their local markets. I mean, real estate is all about knowing your market. And so we look for local operating partners that have track records or the, you know, that have great projects. And so we rely on them. And the way our product is structured is we're very much aligned in the way we structure our product to our sponsors in that, you know, we're very exit focused. So we're kind of on their camp, unlike traditional lenders that will charge you just a rate no matter what. You know, we're very much exit driven.
And tell us sort of why residential? What's the, you know, what's the sort of thesis behind sort of residential specifically?
Well, we love resi. We see that's where the dislocation is. I mean, you've got two parts of the equation, don't you? You've got, the UK or, well, for that matter, all of Europe, but the UK specifically is what we're talking about. You've got a structural shortage, a well-documented structural shortage of housing that's been accumulating over the last 15 years. And you have a funding gap. So, you know, UK government targets to deliver, what is it, the number, the 300,000 that they talk about every year just isn't being, you know, achieved. I mean, in fact, we're falling about 50% short of that every year. So you've got this cumulative demand that's constantly been building up. And the demand drivers that we look at, you know, I mean, which everybody knows is in the last decade, you've had availability of credit, the need for more space, government support programs, and population growth. I mean, the UK is growing in the last decade about 450,000 people a year. So you just kind of do the math and you think, well, there's a lot of demand out there. The problem is that one of the issues is that, you know, there hasn't been that availability of credit since 2008, 2009. That's been available for these SMEs. So our focus isn't on the big house builders. Our focus, or our sweet spot actually, is the SME home builder in the UK. You know, the guys that used to produce upwards of close to 49% of the UK's housing stock. And today, if you look at that, it's kind of closer to 10. And finance is part of the problem. But these are guys that, you know, they've got emotional as well as financial skin in the game. They live in the areas where they build. They know their local markets. And these are the guys that we back. So our typical ticket size tends to run from about 5 up to 25 million. And this is, you know, it's above that area where a lot of the smaller lenders are. And it's below that PE level where sort of the non-bank lenders are playing in. So we think the sweet spot that we're in is pretty good. And we're helping these SMEs deliver housing stock, which, as I said, is down considerably. If you look, I mean, even in the last 12 months, if you look at the CAS report on lending, you know, lending's been down by 40% in the last decade for residential development. And, you know, in the last 12 months, because of COVID, if you look at, and what we do is we look at EPC certificates that are issued on new developments, those certificates are down significantly. And the top 10 UK house builders, they're delivering about 35% less than they were previously. So it's a perfect cocktail. You know, you've got great structural demand for housing, and then you've got lack of finance. So for us, we see that dislocation as a huge opportunity.
Do you see COVID kind of changing that structural demand at all, or what's the impact of the pandemic? It's the sort of question in every sector, but what's the impact of the pandemic on your sector?
Well, I think COVID's just accelerated a lot of trends that were already in place. I mean, the fact that we can do Zoom calls or Teams calls, the fact that more and more people were working from home, shopping from home, and doing all these things, and you know, going from suits to hoodies, you know, that trend's been going on for a long time. COVID's accelerated it. And so I think what COVID's done is it's made people really think about kind of their work-life balance. You know, how many days do you really need to be in the office, you know, without feeling guilty that you have to be there? And so I think, you know, this regional renaissance that everyone talks about is something that we were thinking about 2 years ago. And when we started talking to investors way back when, everybody wanted to be in London. You know, oh no, we're only going to look at London-centric developments. And today that's completely changed. You know, there's been a demand for space, better work life. So people realizing that maybe they don't have to come in more than 2-3 days a week. So I think the demand from the regional markets is going to continue. Does it continue with the same strength that it has over the last 12 months? I don't know, but as a major trend, I think that carries on. And which means that really, you know, if you look at the commuter belt, it just keeps growing, right? And then you've got the secondary cities and the commuter belt, some of those secondary cities keeps growing. So, you know, we're looking at regions and developments that perhaps, you know, a few years ago, nobody really would have looked at. And price appreciation in those markets were far less than London. So, you know, we think we're kind of at the right place at the right time.
Sure, sure. And during the COVID period, you talk about the sort of the long-term trend of kind of banks, you know, traditional lending banks pulling back from development lending. Well, I presume that was probably exacerbated in during the pandemic. I mean, are they ever coming back, the traditional lenders, or is this gonna be a field in which kind of specialists and debt funds like yourselves are pretty much the dominant force?
I think that's the trend. I mean, it all boils down to regulation. I mean, bank lending on this kind of, in this sector, really went down after 2008, 2009. So after GFC, you know, banks really just kind of pulled back. Basel III required banks to hold, you know, anywhere between, depending on how it's structured, 100 to 150% of the capital that they deploy on their balance sheet. So for a lending institution that falls under those regulations, lending in this sector is expensive. And, you know, their ROEs go down. So as a result, over the last couple of years, you've seen the alternatives market significantly increase. But I mean, if you look at the quantum of finance that's needed over, let's say, the next decade, call it 20, you know, in excess of 200 billion, you know, the alternatives have only filled a small portion of that amount, 6 or 7 billion at this point, I think it is. But I think traditional high street clearing banks are probably not coming back, and for a variety, not only because of the regulation, but for other reasons. Residential development lending, or any development lending for that matter, is a real specialty skill. And I think what you saw in the early stages was a lot of peer-to-peers coming in, trying to fill that gap. Volume was driving their business. And you can see what those portfolios look like today. They're terrible. So there was very little or almost no underwriting being done in those deals. And the result, as we all know, from some of the names that have dropped out of the market, are pretty well documented. So I think where we differ is, you know, we understand development, we understand cycles, we understand risk. We're able to underwrite, as many of my peers are, you know, able to do that are coming into this space, with a different degree of skills than, say, a traditional lender who's ticking boxes off on an application form. You know, we actually get our boots dirty. We're very aligned with our partners, as I said.
Sure. And just one last question. How are you seeing the market? Is sort of rented residential, be it BTR or senior living or student? Is that something you're looking at in those kind of commuter belt regions? And how does that shape up compared to sort of build for lending on build to sale schemes?
Well, that's a very good question. I mean, I guess thematically, you know, we'd like to finance anything with a bed. You know, accommodation, basically, whether it's student, whether it's built to rent, whether it's built to sell. I mean, predominantly, we're focused on built to sell right now. The built to rent sector is an interesting one, and it's a difficult one. In the US, you know, multifamily is a huge asset class for institutional investors. Here in the UK, it's less so. And without going into great detail, part of that is just given the land availability to build multifamily. It just really, as an asset class, doesn't exist. It's been trying, and there are people in the market attempting to do that, but it will take some time. But yes, we fund those types of deals, anything kind of in the accommodation sector.
Brilliant. Well, thank you so much for talking us through that, Paul. That's been really interesting. As you say, it's such a fascinating sector. You know, we're sort of taught in Economics 101 that supply and demand should always be in balance. But, you know, huge demand in that residential sector. So interesting to hear about the opportunities created by the lack of supply in financing there. So thank you so much for taking the time to chat about that. Switching to a broader view now of the real estate capital markets and the investment opportunities that we're going to be seeing as the market recovers and as things progress over the next 12 months, I'd like to introduce our panel now, who are going to reveal themselves one by one as I kind of read their names out in the boxing style. Thank you so much.
So I'm going to say thank you, and thank you for everybody that tuned into this, and we'll see you later.
Great stuff. Thank you so much, Paul.